Welcome back to Closing Time with Nick El-Tawil. I'm Nick El-Tawil, and I'm here with Travis Fellmeth and Athena Costanzo, two interior designers with Elle Interiors here in Old Town Scottsdale. What's up, guys?
Hi, how are you?
I'm good, how are you?
Good.
So, okay, let's pretend for a second that people watching, listening, whatever, know absolutely nothing about real estate. Can you guys tell us, what do you do? What does an interior designer do for someone?
So, an interior designer, there's quite a few layers to it. A lot of people think we're just decorators, come in, make their house look pretty, accessorize.
Honestly, that's what I thought. Before I got into real estate, that's what I thought.
That's fair. That's a safe assumption. But there is a lot more. So we can work on anything ground up. We can take care of doing construction plans, like space planning your whole house, like basically rearranging walls. So everything you see on HGTV, that's pretty much what we do. We work with the construction side of it as well, not just the final touches to make something look pretty.
When are you getting your TV show?
Ooh, we'll see. Countdown starting.
That's what everyone asks.
Always.
Real estate somehow is a TV thing now. I don't know why, but
this is true.
It's just what they think.
There's actually also a distinction between a decorator and a designer. I don't think a lot of people realize that either. A decorator is more, I guess you would say that they don't have like a formal education in design. Possibly they do, but it is more focused on just decorating. So filling an existing space with decor, as opposed to a designer who typically has an actual degree, some kind of, you know, level of education. And they actually have more of like a legal standing when it comes to like working with a contractor, for example, and like the permit process. And there's actually a law in Arizona, at least, I'm not sure if this is across the United States, but where unless you are also, if you as an interior designer are also a licensed contractor, you can't actually tell a contractor what to do. It's illegal. It's against the law. And that's because...
What do you mean, tell them what to do? Like, tell them what you want designed?
So, like, say you're on a site visit. You know, you're working with a contractor, but you are also not a licensed contractor. You cannot legally tell that contractor, you know, I think that your opinion is wrong in this situation where like plumbing needs to go or electricity or something like that.
Okay. I can see that. That makes sense. And
so there is, I mean, that's a pretty big distinction between decorator and designer. And like I said, just because you have a degree doesn't mean that you have to be, you know, an interior designer on that level. But it's just something that people don't realize.
So you guys are contractors too.
Our boss is. She is a licensed contractor, and that makes our jobs a lot easier.
Yes.
For sure.
It really does.
Put those contractors in their place.
Absolutely.
All the time.
So let's backtrack a quick second. So when you guys are doing renovations, because you actually do renovations, right? You hire contractors, subcontractors, and you design all the plans for them. And you say, we want the plumbing to go here. We want this to go there.
Correct.
Exactly.
That's huge. See, a lot of people, especially me before I got into real estate, I didn't know that that was that involved for interior
absolutely
design.
It is. So yeah. And, you know, there are a lot of designers who aren't contractors. And like I said, it makes our jobs a lot easier that our boss is, but
your firm, your company, Elle Interiors.
Yes. So typically in that situation, if you aren't a contractor, it helps to hire out somebody like an architect, to actually give you, you know, a full set of drawings that are required for like the permit process, for example. So it's really nice to have to be able to do everything in house as opposed to, you know, contracting out.
Yeah, it definitely makes the process a lot more seamless, especially for projects who do want to like take on the full on remodel scale and not just like picking out tiles and all that, but actually going in and implementing it. It's really rewarding for us especially, but it's also kind of peace of mind for clients too, who are like, yeah, like we want to do everything, but we don't really know where to start. So it's great that we do.
It's also great for the client because in a lot of situations, you actually, as the client, have to hire your own contractor.
Yes.
Aside from an interior designer. So you've got
that's a pain.
Two people who don't necessarily get along because that's kind of, it's kind of like a running joke in the design industry that architects and interior designers don't get along. I mean, it's, that's obviously not true 100% of the time, but, we think very differently. Our perspective on design is very different just because
you're
coming from, you know, an architecture background, which is focused on the building and a designer who's focused on the aesthetic of the building.
And the interior.
And how to fill that space. So that can create, not a lot of problems, but it can create tension, you know, having to hire an interior designer and an architect and, a, you know, a contractor all separately. But yeah, with the company that we work for, it's all basically in-house. So
that's beautiful.
Yeah.
So let's say someone out there has just a basic house, 1,500 square feet, three beds, two baths. They want a full remodel. What does something like that run?
So kind of depending on exactly how much work is going to go into it. If they want to totally gut the whole house, rearrange walls, rearrange plumbing.
Let's say that. They're rearranging walls.
Everything.
They're moving the bathrooms. They want everything.
Okay. So something like that, probably I would say, just also depending on how high end they want to go with finishes, anywhere from maybe like 160,000 to 200,000.
Okay.
Which is a nice range.
That's and that's not terrible. That is about $100 to $120 a square foot, $130 a square foot.
Roughly, yeah.
So, I mean, to build something ground up, it's about $300 a square foot, if not more.
Yeah.
You know, given where we are with the economy.
Exactly.
So to get a full remodel for less than half of that, that's great.
Yeah, it's an amazing option, especially if you find a decent house with decent bones in a great area. I mean, location is everything. So you don't want to be out in the middle of nowhere. Find the perfect place.
It's, and you do obviously have to be careful too with what you're willing to invest in a house that may not be worth what you are actually putting into it.
This is also true.
This is what I tell people too.
Don't double the you know, double the cost of a house, the value of a house in a place where you could never sell it for the value.
Right.
Exactly. That makes absolutely no sense. And then you're stuck with a house that you can't sell.
Right.
You could sell, but for a lot less you pay.
Yes, exactly. So you're, not getting your money, your money's worth. You're probably going to lose money in that situation. So again, that's another reason why if you're looking at it from more of a real estate perspective, you can actually get, you know, maybe hire an interior designer for a few hours of their, of just their opinion on, you know, what can I do to this house to improve it, but not, you know, take it to that level of, you know, losing money rather than making money. You know, most of the time it's, that's never an issue. Cause there's a lot of houses here that, I mean, everywhere you go, there's new builds, there's remodels. So, but the majority of where we work is, you know, Scottsdale, I think, is probably the biggest one right now.
Yeah. Scottsdale has a lot of old houses.
Yeah.
A lot of stuff from the 60s, 70s. Yeah. Not compared to the rest of the United States, it's pretty new, but still needs updating.
Definitely.
For someone who wants to live in it today.
Exactly. And especially everybody who's moving here from out of state, like, probably a pretty different design aesthetic than what they're used to. So, of course, you do want to make it feel like home and just make your house your own, but don't have to break the bank by any means either.
So you guys will do consultations.
Yes.
You said.
Absolutely.
Okay, great.
Yeah.
So let's say someone just wants your opinion. They bring you out to their house. What does that run you?
So at least for where we work, 2 hours worth of our time, it's up to 2 hours, is $300, like a flat fee.
Just a quick $300 and you can get their opinion.
You're not committing to anything. Yeah, it's just getting professional design advice. So
nice. Yeah. And would you recommend like certain trends or certain things that you're seeing that buyers like? Tell us a little bit more about that.
Yeah, so I mean, there's quite a few trends we're seeing right now, and the trends that we're seeing today definitely are different than a year ago or even 2 years ago, especially.
It changes that quick.
Oh yeah, yep. Design is so cyclical.
It's very similar to fast fashion.
Yes.
Okay.
And even more so, you know, as time goes on.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, people are flipping their houses within, you know, 10 years of living in it. So
yeah,
to me, that's pretty quick.
Yeah, 10 years. I mean, 10 years, that's a timeline I understand. But for design trends to change every single year?
It's constant. Yeah, wow. It's constantly changing. I mean, I would say right now, like as far as what's going to be more trendy is kind of like organic contemporary, I guess you can call it. Mm-hmm. So that would be bringing in more like neutral colors versus grays. So bringing in like
grays greens. Out. Gray is dead.
it's definitely out there.
I should be a little bit more specific. Blue gray is dead.
Very cold colors.
Cold colors are out. Warm colors are in.
Yes.
Okay. I had a contractor on here last week. His episode's probably going to be aired by the time this one airs. And he said the same thing. He just used a different word. He said, I think, earthy colors.
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
What he said. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So he said the same thing, just with different words.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
It's so great to hear it from you guys, too.
Yes. And it's good to have contractors who get it. But yeah, definitely earthy tones.
Like if you want to meet Skylar, let me know. I'll hook you up.
Okay. Sounds good. Sounds like a plan. But yeah, for sure. Earthy tones, definitely bringing in more of the browns. And if it is gray, mm-hmm. more of like a grayish or like a taupey gray, mm-hmm. Just not so cold. Mm-hmm. Green is still the color, I would say.
Blue and green. Yeah. I mean, those will always be popular.
Yeah.
We are seeing more of a trend towards red and orange.
Orange.
But again, orange. An earthy, like earthy version of that.
Like rusty.
So not like bright orange.
Right.
Exactly.
Not a primary color.
No.
Orange is secondary. I should know that.
Well.
But yeah, I mean, basically with any design style too, that aspect of it is still the same.
Mm-hmm.
That runs throughout, whether it's contemporary, traditional, eclectic, there's still a thread of, you know, a warm kind of palette mm-hmm. throughout mm-hmm. the styles.
Yeah. Like think mid-century tones, but mm-hmm. not quite as orange.
Right. Not as vibrant, more,
exactly.
more subdued.
Yeah.
For sure.
Yeah. Just warmer, homey, earthy.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And I would say it's interesting to see how the trends change throughout the years and even the mm-hmm. decades. What goes around comes around. It's just a new reiteration of, you know, it's the same thing over and over again.
Mm-hmm.
It's interesting to look at, like, if you think of it in a like historic kind of perspective, give a little bit of historical background to interior design just for a quick minute. There's a book that was written in 1897 called The Decoration of Houses by socialite Edith Wharton.
Oh, we're going back in time, people. Oh my
just
God.
Yes. And she was really kind of a pioneer in a lot of different ways. She was a wealthy socialite from New York. Didn't have a lot to do with her time. So she wrote several books.
We didn't let women vote back then. So
right.
This
right.
Was, and I could imagine.
She was actually a suffragette. She was a pioneer for women's rights.
Well, good for her.
And also just a pioneer of, you know, being defiant to everything that was, you know, the norm for society back then. And that happened to also include interior design. She like I said, she's a very opinionated woman, and she wanted everyone to know what it was that she had to say. So she wrote a book about interior design. And it's really kind of the first time that we see in history interior design kind of coined as, you know, something that is available to people. You know, that's, you know, a service that anybody could provide. You know, we had like decorators is what they call them, but they mm-hmm. installed wallpaper. Like I think one of my great grandparents was a decorator. He installed wallpaper. So that's kind of cool. It runs in the family a little bit, but
real estate. Well, So Athena is my cousin, everybody.
Yes.
Our great-grandfather was a real estate developer in Scottsdale. So it runs in our family.
It only makes sense that we're here.
So yeah, she wrote a book called The Decoration of Houses, and she has a lot of really great things to say. And there's still things that apply to interior design today. And I think a lot of people should take the time to actually read that book. If you are an interior designer, because it sheds a lot of light on, it's just so interesting to see the parallel between, you know, we think of over 100 years ago being very antiquated and out of date, but her ideas and her philosophy of design and life very much still apply to today. Mm-hmm. And that's what makes good design timeless, regardless of what style you have. You know, if you don't even fit in like a style box, there are still elements of design that make it good that will last for centuries, mm-hmm. decades, even centuries. And for her, for Edith, it was all about, you know, minimalism, basically. Let's take it back to classicism. So she was very much in love with like ancient architecture, the Greeks, the Romans. She really wanted to emulate a lot of that in her own home and in the homes of her friends and her clients. And yeah, it was basically just saying, let's do away with all of this extra stuff. You know, the Victorian era is known for being very maximalist, almost to a ridiculous degree. And she just said, this is tacky. This is horrible. We hate it. So that book was very instrumental in interior design becoming more of a mainstream thing. But like I said, it's a great read. It's a little bit heavy because it's like written from, you know, over 100 years ago. But it's really eye-opening, just to see how those things still apply to interior design today.
And that's how you guys know that Travis really loves interior design. He's reading books from 1897 about interior design.
Yeah.
That's pretty cool.
I live and breathe interior design.
Really awesome.
Do. Yeah.
That's wonderful to hear.
And I try to kind of expand my knowledge of it a little bit, you know?
Okay. So, when I was growing up in Arizona, no one had wood floors. And I don't know if you guys noticed this too, but like I lived all over Arizona when I was growing up. My parents moved every few years. So we saw a lot of travertine. We saw a lot of tile floors. Yes. But wood floors were not a thing until recently. Have you guys been noticing this too?
Wood floors? Athena answer that question.
Yeah. So when you look at wood floors, I mean, like there's a couple ways to do it. Like, of course, like if you go back towards like the Midwest or back East or anything like that, you're going to see like your true, real, actual hardwood.
New York, everyone had hardwood.
Exactly.
Everyone.
Exactly. Being in the desert, I think, especially like when we were growing up, people were kind of shying away from wood because tile is a lot colder. Yeah. You're in the middle of 100 degree summers. Like you want it to be cold. But wood flooring, especially like engineered hardwood or like wood look, like luxury vinyl planking, that kind of thing, LVP, if you want to call it that, which is usually how designers refer to it.
Yeah.
Because it's easy. That's definitely making a comeback because it is a lot warmer and just earthier and it feels a little bit more homey. Whereas tile, because it is physically cold, it does feel a little bit cold. But wood flooring is definitely here to stay.
There's also a scientific reason.
Yes.
Give it to me.
And
give it to me, Mr. 1897.
You're going to explain that, please.
So the reason that you see a lot of hardwood in Midwest and the East Coast is because true hardwood is solid wood all the way through.
Mm-hmm.
And even though the wood is dead per se, it's still cellular. So just like
still alive,
so like leather, for example, the reason that like a leather sofa warms up to your skin is because as soon as it makes contact with your skin, it starts to absorb the heat from your body and it opens up the cells of the leather itself, and then the leather absorbs the heat. So the same thing happens with wood. It's a living material. So whenever it comes in contact with moisture, it expands. And when it starts to dry up, it shrinks. So out here in the desert, if you were to install a hardwood floor, it's going to be a disaster. because it's going to start to buckle because that wood is going to move so much. So we never ever recommend installing hardwood in the desert.
No.
You're all about the LVP.
Engineered hardwood.
Next step down.
I'm 100% with you.
Yeah.
Next 100%. Step down from that is engineered hardwood. So that is a real veneer layer of wood basically glued to a substrate of some kind. And there are different kinds, but the most common is like a plywood substrate. And then that creates your plank of wood flooring.
And you can still like sand that, refinish it a couple of times, not as much as like a true solid hardwood. But I mean, to what Travis was saying about like expanding and shrinking and all of that, like that's why if you do go into an older home with hardwood, you will see like cracks against the wall, like gaps in the wall, like between where that meets the floor and just like cracks throughout and like gapping throughout, because wood does expand and shrink so much. So
and with the engineered hardwood, because it isn't so thick of a material, and just the way that it's been engineered, it's able
almost
to.
Why they call it that,
right?
Who would have thought? It's able to move in a way that it needs to. So it's much more practical. It isn't necessarily a money saver, because a lot of the time the price is very comparable.
Well, it saves you money because you don't have to repair it down the line. So long term, it saves you money.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yes. And I would say another reason why wood flooring is becoming more popular is because we're seeing more of a trend with traditional design coming back. So we're in the design world, we're kind of calling it new traditional, because it's not like, you know, like a granny house.
But that is a thing.
It is still a thing. It's not for everyone. It shouldn't be a thing, in my opinion.
Wait, granny house. Backtrack one step. Let's explain to the audience what a granny house is.
I mean, grandma core is literally a subcategory of
grandma
design.
Core.
Granny it's
core.
A thing.
Granny core.
Yeah, bringing in like doilies, floral blankets, like
lace
basically
curtains.
Think, yeah, I think like, your grandma's house in the 60s.
I feel like this is like a new genre of music. Like
yeah.
Horrorcore, like granny core.
It's real.
Yes,
it's a real thing.
It's real. It's real.
So definitely don't think along those lines, because that's not what we mean.
Yeah.
But
we mean design. Design.
Yes. Yeah, okay. It's just a rebirth of things that make your house feel like it's been lived in.
Yeah.
You know, that's like you've inherited, you know, this beautiful rocking chair that's like 150 years old. I think people are embracing that lived in feeling, you know, and there's character, something with patina or has a story. It's a really interesting object. And just kind of the layered feeling of traditionalism, lots of comfortable fabrics, lots of patterns, not necessarily lots of colors, but just a real focus on comfort and kind of authenticity with a home. Because when you walk into a like super contemporary home, it doesn't feel comfortable. You know, it's cool. It's cool to look at. It's a piece of art. It can be beautiful, but it doesn't feel like somewhere that you want to relax. And I think that was, you know, kind of with like the millennial generation, you know, we were kind of the ones leading the way with what was popular in the past 10 years.
Yeah.
And we kind of were like also pushing back against, you know, I think that traditional, it was pretty popular in the 90s and the early 2000s with like Tuscan design. That is kind of a take on traditionalism. So we were pushing against that and saying, I don't want what my parents have.
We want the opposite. So let's take it all completely
let's
back.
Let's pare it back. Let's take all the walls. Let's have open concept living, paint everything gray, and have a lifeless home. And that was seen as contemporary and cool and the thing to do. So again, trends come and go, and there's always a reason for it. And so now I think, especially with like post, you know, pandemic, as people started to spend more time with, you know, in their homes and with their families, it just kind of rewired our brains in the way that we think about like our home life. Mm-hmm. So it's like, okay, now my home, it needs to be comfortable. Mm-hmm. I'm here a lot more. I'm spending quality time with my family. And it needs to feel like a space that's inviting.
Exactly.
And I think that's probably one of the biggest reasons why it is becoming more popular, is because there's so much more focus on home than there ever really has been in a pretty long time.
Mm-hmm. And I totally agree with that. And like, even just like going into like some design elements too, like with bringing it more traditional, like you do see in more traditional homes, like wall trim, coffered ceilings, like beams, all of that. That's coming back for sure, just in a more updated, modern, current way. Mm-hmm. So it's definitely taking those elements and just updating it, making it just
more fresh.
Yeah.
Like a fresher version.
More 2020s than.
Yeah.
So we don't really have a ton of homes out here that just naturally have the beams and all that.
Nope.
Do you guys?
Unless it's Tuscan, like fake Tuscan.
Yeah, fake yes. Tuscan.
Which is terrible. I don't like that.
So you're saying you don't design homes like that? Or you would?
Well.
Would you recommend it? What do you think?
Depends on the context.
Exactly. Okay. So beams, we do love beams. I actually just worked on a fantastic project up in Prescott. We added faux beams instead of like real actual solid wood beams because those are heavy, and faux beams are great nowadays because they look real and you would never know unless you go into the ceiling and touch them.
You know what's interesting is on YouTube, I watch a lot of YouTube. it's my entertainment of choice, which is where I learn a lot of what I know, by the way. I highly recommend YouTube.
you guys might be watching this on YouTube. So
I've actually been seeing kind of a lot of hate against like faux beams.
Really?
And like kind of more of like the quote unquote DIY type design elements in a home.
Interesting.
Well, DIY.
I mean, DIY.
Yeah, like, well done. Well done DIY.
Yeah, if it's not DIY.
If they're hiring a pro,
because
you can
install faux beams yourself. Yeah.
Absolutely.
You know, you can do it DIY. So yeah, just a lot of hate against that. And I don't really understand why, because it's an affordable way to get the look that you want. It might not be actual wood, but not everybody can afford that.
Exactly. And not everybody can even really tell the difference, to be totally honest. So especially if it's like tall ceilings, like you're not going to know.
This backlash is also towards like TikTokers.
Yeah.
So I feel like there's might be something to be said about that. So.
Generational hate there.
Yes.
Yeah.
It's just coming to surface.
Right.
I'm a fan of beams, but I feel like you need high ceilings.
Exactly.
Because the traditional, when I was in New York, we saw, you know, homes that just naturally had beams, and it was always like 10 plus ceilings had the beams.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So
beautiful.
Yeah. If you want to do faux beams, I feel like you need naturally high ceilings to make it work.
Yeah, you kind of do. I mean, because they do add an extra layer up there too. So, I mean, if you add them to a really tall ceiling, it is going to feel cozier and more homey and. Like
I would say there's probably one exception to that, and that would be like, say you buy, you know, like a 1920s.
Those are rare out here, sir.
Well, in Phoenix.
In Phoenix.
You know, the Willow kind of neighborhoods where they have those 1920s cottages.
Exactly.
Say that you have like a low ceilinged, like attic bedroom. I feel like you could add beams there. Because it makes sense in the context of the architecture.
Exactly.
Yes.
As opposed to like just kind of a, you know, basic tract home in Arizona that's from like 2005 that has high ceilings, like, or even low ceilings. It's just not necessarily going to make sense. You know, you're not putting it there just to look pretty. Mm-hmm. It's also about the context of your style, the style of the house, the location. It all comes into play with making those kinds of decisions.
Absolutely.
In California, New York, they call those 1920s homes pre-war, because pre-World War II. That's not really a word here in Arizona. People don't.
No.
We just don't have that many of them.
Unless you're talking about the Civil War.
It's even older. Arizona wasn't a state back then. But we do have some of those classic homes, like you were talking about. Central Phoenix, Willow neighborhood. Everything there is pre-war, 1920s, 1930s.
Beautiful.
Yeah, it's a beautiful neighborhood.
I'm also, very envious. It's like my dream.
One of my friends, real estate broker, she bought a house in Willow and she lived there. She only lasted a couple of years. She had to move because she worked, like her office is in Scottsdale. Mm. And she said commuting from downtown to Scottsdale every day. Like it didn't save her any time. Like it wasn't like a convenient location for her. Yeah, so she had to move. But I feel like if you, you know, live and work more central all day. I live in Willow all day.
I commute here from Central Phoenix.
Do you?
I do.
Where do you live?
Indian School and Central Avenue area.
Okay.
So well, it's Indian School Park.
Yeah. It's a little farther north than Willow.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But same distance across.
Yeah. So, same distance across.
I like that part of town for the historic charm. You know, it feels like there's something, you know, it has some history, has a little bit of culture. I lived in Scottsdale and I didn't enjoy it. and I really do think that it has a lot to do with the value that like historic architecture brings to a neighborhood.
Agreed.
You know, value not just monetarily, but also, you know, like emotionally and, you know, how, like just how it makes you feel.
Yes.
Which sounds a little meta and weird and like, what is he talking about? But at least for me, because I am very emotional when it comes to interior design, I have to be surrounded by, you know, those things that feel special.
Mm-hmm.
And to me, you know, kind of basic contemporary architecture is not special. It doesn't make me feel a certain way. So I moved back to Central Phoenix because I like to see, you know, the bigger trees that have been there for a lot longer, mm-hmm. like the beautifully like manicured lawns and these cute little houses. It just feels so much more authentic.
I agree 100%. North Scottsdale definitely has that new vibe. The farther north you go, the more new it feels.
Mm-hmm.
I feel like South Scottsdale still has a lot of the same character. A lot of these homes are 1950.
Yes. You know, and it isn't to say that like mid-century modern architecture doesn't also make me feel that way because I love mid-century modern.
Of course.
I'm a bit of a mid-century modern geek.
This is true, I can attest.
Love it. And I want that, you know, that era of house when I can afford a home. So, and there's also brand new houses that, you know, as long as it's well done and that there's a lot of thought and emotion put into the design of a contemporary home, if you can feel that, if you can, you know, walk into that space and it makes you feel a certain way, because somebody has put so much time and effort into it, that's another kind of aspect of what makes interior design good as opposed to, you know, a house that has never felt any love by anyone ever.
Exactly.
And not even by the person that built it.
Right. And there's so many homes like that. But I mean, I think that is such a good point to bring up too. Like as interior designers, that's what we're here for. We're here to make like your home and your space feel somewhere that like is inspiring to you all the time. Like
it's a personal thing.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. It's so personal and everybody has such different like just what makes them happy. So if like Scottsdale is not for you, Scottsdale might be great for somebody else. Same with like downtown. Like it's just, it's totally so unique, which is what's really fascinating, I think, about this career and like just this whole field is everybody's views are so different. Mm. So what makes one client happy is going to make another client upset. But that's
and I would
just
say
the joy
of it. If there's one kind of tip when it comes to like hunting for a home, or trying to figure out what your style is. And it's to not look at what the trends are.
Yes.
Because a trend will die. We know this. This is what we just talked about.
Mm-hmm.
It's here today and gone tomorrow. So take a little bit more time to think about, like, what is it that makes you happy, you know?
Absolutely.
Like, drive around, look at houses. Look at the architecture and, you know, figure out what aspects of it kind of make you light up, that get your heart racing. You know, I have a very visceral reaction to good design. Like I'll get like a literal like tingle in my stomach. And that's how I know that I'm looking at something good, is because I have an actual physical reaction to it. And
spidey senses.
Exactly. Right. Just take note of those things.
Those beamed ceilings.
So good. And just try to think about it more personally and don't even think about what other people are doing.
Exactly. I mean, like one thing that we always have clients do too is like look on Pinterest or House and just look at spaces and rooms, like not even necessarily like, oh my God, I love that cabinet color. Like look at the like whole space as a whole and be like, yeah, this feels good. This feels like what I want my house to feel like. Mm-hmm. So whether it's physically going and looking at things or just looking online, like you'll figure out what makes you happy.
Okay, backtrack 1 second. Is yes. Pinterest still a thing?
Absolutely.
I love Pinterest.
You guys are all about
Pinterest?
It's my
Pinterest? Second yes. favorite app.
Okay. Okay.
Yes. Right under YouTube. YouTube, Pinterest.
I mean, and if you're not into Pinterest, House does the same kind of thing.
Houzz.
Okay, but I thought Pinterest was going to be big. So like 2015, 2016, when I really started getting into social media,
yeah.
I made a Pinterest and I was like going hard at it.
Same.
And I just kind of lost interest over time.
Yeah.
And same. I haven't really heard much about it since, but I'm glad you bring it up.
I think yeah. the people who kind of stayed on that bandwagon mm-hmm. are like the creatives, kind of the more like the quiet creative people mm-hmm. That are kind of just minding their own business. And like, for me, it's almost like I'm creating a fantasy world for myself.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It's hoarding without the stuff.
Because that's a good way
like,
to put it.
Just like save all of this stuff that I wish that I had.
Pinterest, we have a new logo for you guys. Hoarding without the stuff, Pinterest.
Let's make it happen. but yeah, I mean, it's an easy way to kind of like just find inspiration, mm-hmm. you know? And again, it's like, you're curating your own stuff, you know, your own inspiration, as opposed to like with Instagram or TikTok, with your for you page, it's going to just feed you all of this stuff that it thinks that you want.
Mm-hmm.
And it's obviously going to be stuff that's like popular, you know, mm-hmm. 'cause like on those social media platforms, I mean, that's what social media is for. It's like, what's new, what's exciting, what's, you know, what's the newest thing. But with Pinterest, you know, it's not like that. The setup is different. So
yeah, it's what you want when you want to see it, not exactly. just like everything at once. Like, I mean, for me personally, I use it for design inspiration all the time. Just
mm-hmm.
it's easy. It's great. There's so much out there. Or like, I mean, recipes, like clothing inspiration, even like stuff mm-hmm. like that. Like, I think it depends on like what you're using it for. And I totally agree. Like more creative side versus actually using it as like a social media platform, mm-hmm. I think is the biggest difference.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, definitely. I think a great spot for inspiration in any sense.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Find your inspiration on Pinterest. Travis, Athena. Do you guys have anything else for us today?
I mean, I could talk all day long.
Same.
I'm in a safe space, so I feel comfortable and I like to just talk about what I love, but yeah, I feel like we covered a lot of great stuff. So.
Call them, let Travis talk to you because he can talk all day. Elle Interiors, Old Town Scottsdale. It's Athena Costanzo and Travis Fellmeth. My name's Nick El-Tawil. See you guys next week.
Bye.